Thank you. Thanks to Piyush and Swati for bringing me over here, especially Piyush for convincing me to come here. Okay, and I'm glad I made this trip. I should also thank my family for making it possible. Okay, I'm going to talk. I come from the ecology theory side of things. Okay, I'm going to try and demystify some of the jargon and theory for our landscape architect crowd. I hope I don't leave the ecologist crowd a bit disappointed, because this is not a very dense data talk or something like that. This is plain nuts and bolts kind of talk. Okay. Well, I'll start off with some basic ideas. Okay, I'll just bounce these ideas off you. It may look like a bunch of odd ideas strung together. I hope it makes sense at the end of it all. Okay. There are these wonderful studies from Northern Europe and Northern America, which have looked at pollen in fossil pollen, and try to understand how trees responded to past climate change events during the last glacial maxima. Okay, about 10 to 30,000 years ago, glaciers were contracting and spreading, and there was it was a very dynamic times in terms of glaciers. Okay, along with that, we had a whole bunch of species, and the best studied are oaks and pines. And as glaciers contracted and moved polewards, the distribution of these trees also spread polewards. Okay, and as glaciers spread towards the equator, of course, the range of these species contracted. Okay, now the only constant thing about the Earth has been the fact that environmental conditions have been constantly changing. Climate change is one constant factor that all species have had to factor into their lifetimes, into their evolutionary lifetimes, and thinking, and you know, they've all managed to come up with strategies to enable them to survive constant changing environmental conditions. Okay, if we zoom out a bit, zoom out of Pune, zoom out of India, zoom out of all these places, and think of species ranges and how that's changing and responding to past and ongoing climate change events. Okay, the surprising thing is, you know, plants are rooted in a place. They can't just get up and walk away. Okay, if something, you know, there's a fire, or it gets really warm or really cold or really wet, and it becomes unsuitable for me, if I'm a tree, I can't just get up and walk away. Okay, the only thing I can do is spread my seeds really far and wide and hope that some of them land in a place which is suitable in the future, in a few decades down the line, for them to grow and establish. Okay. So it's really long-term thinking. It's like putting fixed deposits. They're banking every year, producing thousands and millions of seeds every year. Very few of which survive, less than 0.01% sometimes. But they're banking, spreading it really far and wide, so that some of it hopefully will survive in the future. Okay. Now, the studies on the fossil pollen are really fascinating, because they've told us, shown us the rate at which species, plant species, have responded to past climate change events. Okay, and the rates are astounding, 1 to 10 kilometers an year. Okay, that kind of rate is just not possible if, you know, a tree standing in a place drops a few seeds here, that establishes, another tree comes up. You know, passive dispersal will not give us the rates of 1 to 10 kilometers an year. The very rapid movements witnessed in the past climatic change events, okay, could have only happened due to very long distance dispersal. Okay, very, very long distance dispersal. Those of us who understand a little bit about seed dispersal, we know that such really long distance dispersal events are very rare, very rare. Okay, most seeds fall close to the parent tree. A few may be taken tens of meters away from the parent tree, but 1 in 1,000 or 10,000 or 1,000,000 goes beyond a kilometer or more. Okay, but these rare events seem to drive plant responses to climate change. Okay, and there are very few very few dispersal vectors that can bring about really long really long dispersal distances. Okay, and these very rare events are mediated in the case of, you know, plants that are dispersed by water, by ocean currents, okay? In the case of plants that are dispersed by wind uplifts. And for a majority of tropical plants which are dispersed by animals, it's really large-bodied animals which move very long distances in short periods of time that can bring about these kind of distances, okay? Now, all of that, of course, when viewed in the context of what is happening in present-day ecosystems, it's completely messed up, okay? We live in highly fragmented landscapes. This is, in fact, a less fragmented landscape than where most of us live. I wish I had taken a picture here from Pune this morning. This is from Valpara in the Annamalais, a fragmented forest landscape in the middle of tea and growing urbanization. And think of a species which is found here on the hilltop and nowhere else or in very few places, which needs to now get across tea estates and you know, whole bunch of human settlements and then get across to a hill much further away, even just 10 kilometers away, the kind of barriers it has to face in its movement, okay? Even for a bird or a mammal, it becomes challenging. But just think of a plant species which is trying to navigate landscapes like this through its seeds and where it can't really control where those seeds end up too well. I mean, plants really can't control animal movement too well, okay? But they can to a certain extent, they're very smart. So today, in today's landscapes, okay, plant migration, as we call it, in response to changing climates, is extremely difficult, okay? We face a decline in the densities and the kinds of animal dispersers that once moved seeds around. Most of the big guys are gone in most places, even inside forest habitats. The remaining habitats are really fragmented and it's, as I said, very hard to imagine how you connect them. And also, of course, the spaces around the remaining natural habitats are increasingly converted to very intensive human use. Every surface cemented, like Swati was showing, which just makes it impermeable to movement of any kind of species, okay? So yes, why do we need to restore? I think in present day landscapes, if we want to enable some kind of ecological functioning dynamics to kind of enable species to move around and sort themselves out for whatever, okay, responding to climate change or in search of food or whatever it is, okay, we need to be able to address how we nurture little patches of little islands in the middle of this vast human ocean that we've created, okay. And today we face reduced ranges for many of our species, okay, be it from plants to very large mammals. Several plant species are on the verge of extinction, okay. We don't even know, we don't have enough people going and documenting these things, okay. We have a very small proportion of our country which is strictly protected, and even there, many of the areas are heavily degraded. Across all landscapes, species survival is challenged by multiple driving forces, most of which are made much worse under climate change, okay. Well, we had this debate in the last session, and I'm glad other speakers kicked it off. In India, I think we are still at very early ages of thinking through what are the targets, I mean, what is this vision we have when we approach a restoration project. Often, the reference has been drawn from, you know, what it was in the past. People spend a lot of time looking at floras and trying to understand descriptions of the site, and also looking sideways, okay? Looking to a nearby area somewhere in the vicinity and trying to understand its floristic composition to understand what we bring back into our ecosystems, okay? But ecosystems, as we all know, are dynamic entities, okay? They're constantly responding to changes, both human induced changes and natural environmental changes that are going around, okay? And we of course need forward looking benchmarks, okay? We need to think of how we're going to make these systems resilient, how we're going to build ecosystems that can kind of, you know, cope up with the changes we anticipate in a few decades from now, okay? And we need to kind of build these in such that they're self-sustaining. Okay, it shouldn't take too much intervention every year, a lot of money and investment every year to keep them going. Okay, we're never going to find that kind of money. Okay, if we want to do that. So in this context, I think ecology and ecological theory has a lot to offer. And we need more ecologists who are ready to spend time, who are ready to get outside the bounds of, you know, strictly academic work and try to work with other disciplines who are also taking an ecological approach and try and apply what we understand in partnership with other groups of people working towards the same goals. Okay? It's challenging, it's not easy, and there are no answers out, clear answers out there, but it's definitely worth trying to find solutions. So let's come back to this other debate that was going on today, and I think this is something that we often grapple with when we work with restoration projects. Okay, so what is a native species? Okay, all of you will say, of course, lantana. Okay, that's exotic, foreign, in whatever it is. It's not native to India. Okay, the image on the other hand of tamarind. How many of you think tamarind is native to India? Nobody here thinks tamarind is native to India. You think that tamarind is native to India. Who else says, come on, be brave. Do you think tamarind is native to India? Okay. You used to think, okay? So majority of us, let's admit, at one point of time, given the name Tamarindus indica, thought that tamarind is native to India. Now we understand it probably originated in Africa and moved to India a very, very long time ago. We don't know how long ago. There are many such examples of trees which may have moved by the human agency or ocean currents or whatever it is and landed on the Indian shores. Coconut or Adansonia, various other species. Really fascinating to understand how they moved across continents. Now, species movement across continents has also again been a constant feature, okay, across the globe. Humans have accelerated it. Humans are a major agent of species movement across the globe today. But I think in the context of restoration, instead of trying to break our heads about what is native and what's not native to a place, which is extremely hard to define, okay? And it's also extremely hard to say, okay, would that species not have come here by itself if we had not introduced it, okay? That's also a question which is very, very difficult to answer, okay? I think it's more useful to focus our energies, attention, and money and efforts on this word, okay? What is invasive? Okay, and that's the word that is a clincher. That's the word that will make sure whether your program succeeds or fails. That's the word that determines how much money you need to invest and go on investing every year. Okay, and you can also be very clever about how you manage invasive species. Okay, let's look at a few ideas. Okay, now what's an invasive species? That's also a very good question. Okay, an invasive species is not just an exotic species which has come from somewhere else. It can also be a native species. In many parts of India, we have Adathoda vesica, which is a native plant native to India, which has turned invasive. Okay, we also have invasive grasses. A lot of African grasses are invasive in India. Okay, and an invasive species is something that's gone through a boom. Okay, it was found there. And then it went through a period when it started taking over all the space available in the ecosystem and now dominates the ecosystem. It has a huge impact on other species. Several other species are driven out of the ecosystem. They're competed out, okay? Or because of them, like because you have an invasive grass or lantana or something taking over the ecosystem, there's less food available to herbivores. Lantana produces such sweet nectar that it steals pollinators from native trees. Huge impacts on native ecosystems. It also has huge costs for humans. Okay, these ecosystems in India, especially, have always been used by humans in so many ways. Okay, when we have invasive taking over these ecosystems, especially the unpalatable ones, grazing lands have become less palatable. Okay, we have less food for our livestock as well. Okay, so, why do we need to address invasives for ecological restoration? We have a bunch of people in Delhi, for example, who said, and in Delhi, we have many invasives, one dominant one being Prosperous juliflora. There's several restoration projects in Delhi which say we can just chop off the top, the crowns of Prosperous juli flora trees. Plant native species. The native species will grow and then they will shade out the juli flora trees. Well, sorry, okay. Prosperous is doing a whole bunch of things. It's modifying soils, the serious effects called allelopathic effects. It releases chemicals into the soil, which makes it very, very hard for other species to go. It also competitively, it kind of, you know, competes. It's such a fantastic competitor and doesn't have any natural enemies here. It's something that our native plants just can't cope with, okay? And also there's a loss of whole bunch of ecological services, both to other species and to humans when you have things like prosopis or lantana taking over ecosystem, is completely, okay? When we don't remove invasive species, when we are lazy to remove invasive species, when we do our restoration projects, okay, we have very poor ecosystem recovery, okay? And we can go and measure this in various ways. When we don't invest in removing invasive species, we have very, very poor ecosystem recovery. We have very poor carbon sequestration, whatever you name it, okay? You take any parameter, okay? Bird recovery, insect recovery, whatever parameter, it's very, very poor, okay? Step one, address invasives, okay? Now, is removing invasives and addressing soils enough, okay? With this very interesting project going on around Bandipur in Karnataka, where this guy has gone and says he's restored about 2,400 hectares by removing lantana and digging pits around there and just addressing a bit of soil and you know, water retention and stuff. Is that enough? Okay, and that's the question that many of you asked today. Is that enough? Okay, just should we introduce seeds? Should we introduce species? Well, okay, the answers depend on what your worldview of restoration or what is your vision for that site, okay? But, you know, let's just look at what happens when we don't introduce seeds or species in other ways, okay? We have widespread invasive species like Lantana camara, which, you know, you remove from your little site, patch, whatever. And if you, there are high costs involved in removal, very, very high costs involved in the first time removal. All of us know that, okay? And removal is rarely effective if we do not introduce grasses or something to take over that place immediately, okay? If you do not do it the same monsoon bed season, bang, you have lantana back in 2 months, okay? All that effort you put in, all that money you put in has gone down the drain, okay? So we spend millions of dollars annually, even from the government of India, to eradicate lantana. This is a widespread, long, persistent invasive species, okay? And so my colleagues and I spend a lot of time trying to understand why do species like lantana come back so quickly into spaces that were managed for lantana, okay? Now, the first thing that lantana, you know, lantana has black fruits, okay, that are really sugar rich, and it produces lots and lots of fruit through the year, multiple fruiting seasons. And these attract a whole range of animals. Just about everybody comes to lantana to eat the fruits. And these fruits are carried in the bellies of birds and mammals which eat these fruit, and they go and poop it out somewhere, okay? Different animals retain seeds in their bellies for different periods of times. Okay, bulbuls shit it out generally in about 10 minutes. Okay, others like bears retain it for hours. Okay, nevertheless, all of them are moving in very complex ways while, you know, keeping these seeds in their bellies, and where they decide to poop depends on their behavior, their pooping behavior. Okay, birds generally like to sit on a perch and then poop. Bears look for open surfaces. Okay. So we spent a lot of years trying to understand, okay, who eats lantana? What proportion of fruit is removed by different animals, fruit-eating animals, otherwise called as frugivores, okay? We also spent a lot of time studying animal movement, okay? We put transmitters on them, went after them with, you know, various equipment to track their movements, from bulbuls to cheetal to civets, whatnot. We tracked all their movement. And we also fed fruit to these birds and mammals to understand how long they retain the seeds. Now combine all these three layers of information to derive what we call seed dispersal kernels, okay, which are predictive surfaces, which just tell us how far a seed is carried from the parent plant. How quickly does lantana move? How does it move? How far does it move? Okay. Now, we did this for other species that disperse lantana as well. Bulbuls eat 50 to 55% of the fruit everywhere in the country that we studied it. They're major dispersers for lantana, okay? Now, okay, let's see what we found, okay? We found that lantana seeds occasionally can reach a kilometer or more, okay? But most of the seeds land very close to the parent, within 50 meters, okay? This 20.7 indicated there by an arrow, okay, is the median distance of the source plant in these cleared areas, okay? Now, the source nearest source plant for an area which has been cleared, various places where we went and saw lantana had been cleared, we measured how far is the nearest source plant. It was just 20.7 meters away, okay? And that falls well within the distances to which most lantana seeds fall, leave aside long distance dispersal, okay? Again, when we looked at the eradication programs being run by the Government of India, and we're working with the government at the site, and we did try to make them understand that, you know, from your clearings, that the nearest source plant is so close by, seeds are coming in within few weeks or few days because lantana fruits so copiously, okay? Now, to effectively remove widespread invasives like lantana, in lieu of its dispersal, we need very clever techniques. We need to know the dispersal distances, and we need to manage areas and keep it larger than that maximum distance. Okay, we can't do small clearings here and there. Okay, we need careful soil treatments to address the allelopathic effects, and of course, we need immediate introduction of seeds and saplings of other species if we want to stop lantana from coming back. Okay, we need to get there before lantana gets there. Now, is addressing invasives enough? Is introducing seeds enough, or do we need to do something more? Okay. Now, often, we have this issue of seeds failing to arrive, okay, into ecosystems by themselves because of limited dispersal. Dispersal limitation is a very serious thing, even in natural ecosystems with a complete dispersal profile. Okay. But think of degraded ecosystems where just about everything is messed up. Dispersal limitation is big, huge, okay? We can measure it, quantify it. Now, alongside that, we have another limitation called recruitment limitation. Your seeds arrive, even then there's a very, very, very low chance of them surviving. Now, for certain species, you know, it's perfectly fine to just introduce seeds. They can come up on their own, especially grasses and small-speeded herbaceous species. You don't need to go and, you know, create nurseries and invest a lot of money understanding how to grow them, okay? They grow very well on their own, especially the species that are coming from extremely degraded sites, the bad guys, okay? They can grow very, very quickly, establish very quickly without much nourishment, even in poor soils, okay? But there are guys, especially the large seeded species, the extremely rare species, habitat specialists, whatever, which need a lot of thought, energy, efforts, money, and to bring them back is very, very hard. We need specialized nurseries. We often need to create specialized habitats and to bring some of these specialized guys back if you're trying to bring them back into ecosystems. And not just planting them, when we want to bring a population of these back so that they grow on and they go and maintain themselves, okay? Not just planting them here and there, but to kind of make self-maintaining populations out there, okay? Now, we also have, even if you do all of this, okay, we had this case in a site that I was working in Delhi, in the NCR region, where we had a very common understory plant, Helictus isora, which, brought in seeds, tried nursery techniques, everything, and it just didn't grow, okay? We then started sourcing seeds from multiple locations. And finally, the Helictus is an extremely common widespread understory shrub. If finally the seeds that germinated in Gurgaon were coming from Orissa, okay, as far as Orissa. Several friends of mine from Australia who work on a restoration who'd come to visit our site in Gurgaon kept advising us, go for warmer seeds, go for warmer seeds, okay? And it's true, across sites now, across the world, people are finding this, practically discovering this, as well as, of course, scientists like us churning out papers saying, you need to now start looking for seeds from warmer sites, even if it's for the same species. You need to start mixing these things, bring in greater genetic diversity, because we just don't know, okay, from one year to the next, who's going to survive, okay? Maybe the seeds we have in our own site do not have, you know, that window to kind of respond to the climatic changes that are going on in our site, okay? Even if it's the same species. We need to go and source seeds from elsewhere. Earlier, the philosophy was that we should only source seeds locally and as close, I mean, the same species and the trees around that area, and, I mean, shrubs around that area. But now that's changing. We're saying, okay, relax local, you know, somewhere around the vicinity. We're also trying to do composite planting. Like we pick up a few local seeds, few from multiple locations, okay? And various other kinds of mixture plantings. You're also thinking of cultivars, which do specifically are suited for future climatic conditions or certain conditions, extremely salty soil conditions that we have in degraded ecosystems across the country. Okay, we also have predictive restoration efforts in other parts of the world, not in India, where they've actually gone and understood, okay, what's the future conditions like for soils, for water, for temperatures, and then kind of come up with a species mix and also seed mix that is most suitable for coming decades. Okay, so put it in a nutshell, a friend of mine who's not an ecologist, who's not a landscape architect, but he's constantly experimenting and trying out these things to grow the things that are most suited in for that place. It's just go give it a try. Okay, you don't need to go follow definitions out there. Don't be scared. Give it a try. Okay, because today a lot of things that worked even 5 years ago are not working in our sites. 10 years ago are not working in our sites. Okay. The other issue, of course, we face all the time is that saplings fail to survive. This is for trees, of course, woody plant species. We have several issues. And these, of course, that each of us have found innovative ways to address this in our sites. Okay. This question comes up. IAC is supposedly going and seed bombing, and I was shocked, appalled, horrified. And the kind of species listed on that seed bombing experiment, Phyllanthus emblica, Tamarindus indica, all of that, they're not seeds that you can go and seed bomb. Why? Okay, they're not seeds that are, just going to pop up and germinate if you spread those seeds around. Okay, these seeds are recruitment limited. They need very special situations for them to germinate and grow. Those things are not there. Okay, and you could seed bomb grass seeds and some herbaceous plants, and that may work in some places, but for most situations, it's just a useless propaganda, okay? So, I don't know if we have time for this. We can come back to this. If you have questions, I can give this out as a handout about the trajectory, the thought processes we can follow, and decisions we can make about what to do at a site and what to do for particular kinds of species, okay? And there's no prescription, but all I would say is that I think it needs closer assimilation, engagement and collaborations between ecologists and landscape architects and whoever else is trying to address this practically. It's not just about native species. There's a lot of other decisions to be taken, and I think it's always useful to work in consultation with an ecologist. Okay. There's also some other learnings that I wanted to share with you very quickly. We worked a lot on civets, and we tracked their movement patterns in urban Dehradun and tried to understand how they disperse seeds in a very, very densely populated landscape. Okay, we have civets. Civets are amazing. They eat large seeds, okay, which very few animals in urban landscapes can now disperse, okay, because all the large frugivores are gone and no one else is left. And their diet is mostly fruit. They just poop lots and lots and lots of seeds, okay. Well, we've been thinking of starting a restoration project just from poop, okay, and that's how one of the restoration projects I worked on in the Valparais started. We started working with civet poop, okay, and it's really a cost-effective way to maximize the diversity of plants you want to introduce in numbers, okay. From different dispersers, you can get different seeds. If you understood the system well enough, you know which dispersers to go and catch for which kind of seeds, okay. And seeds come, when you collect them from home, they come in clean packages. You don't need to invest lots of money in cleaning them, okay? You also get chemically treated seeds, which often do better than, the seeds that you just pick up from a plant, okay? But hey, watch out for invasives, because these animals are also dispersing invasives. Make sure you're not spreading invasives when you're picking up seeds from poop, okay? We've been studying the systems there for some time now, and we understand the different modules, the units that are out there, okay, which animals disperse, which components of the plant community, and in a non-overlapping way, okay. The services are non-overlapping, these seven groups. And if we had one representative at least from each of these communities, those services would be maintained. But unfortunately, that's not what's happening, okay? We did this with very intensive work. We spent hours and hours in front of fruiting trees, you know, watching them, trying to see which animals came and ate the fruit, then going and looking at their poop and tracking their movements and all of that stuff. And we understand now for tropical dry forest systems, both in northern and southern India, about who disperses whom and how much they disperse. We also understand how that changes when you go from forest to rural and urban landscapes, okay? And, but unfortunately, for plant-pollinator interactions in India, okay, we don't have a single network, okay? And I saw a lot of posters here about addressing pollination in urban landscapes. What we need is plain, simple natural history, okay? Not just ticking off a list of plants and a list of insects. We need guys to go and sit there, sit in front of a plant like you were doing around campus, not just see that plant, but sit there in front of a fruiting tree or a flowering plant and see which animals come and pollinate it or disperse its seeds. These are very simple things to do. I could come and teach it, or anybody, a lot of ecologists here could come and train you. Very simple things to do, okay? You can then design ecosystems in better ways if you had good natural history information. And this is what I think ecologists need to do more, we need more applied knowledge that can support a lot of efforts like this. We cannot just be sitting on our high horses and saying, this is wrong, that's wrong, but we need to provide the knowledge that's useful, okay? Just a few thoughts and then we'll wrap up, okay? What we understand, of course, all of you understand as well, that isolated trees are very important stepping stones in present-day landscapes, okay? Especially in the context of climate change, when you think of species movement, okay, it's really, really, really important step. I can't tell you how important. Similarly, thinking about, and here there's a bunch of landscape architects, maybe someday becoming town planners, please do think about how we design cities to enable canopy connectivity. How do we connect, okay? Retaining canopy connectivity is critical to maintain the last remaining populations of those civets and hornbills that still live with us in our cities, okay? They're almost gone, they become extremely rare, okay? And there's also a lot of ecological knowledge that we can use to make, we can use to accelerate restoration efforts, which can bring down the costs of these programs. We know that existing vegetation acts as foci for seed rain. It also acts as a foci for all the nutrition, that fertilization that poop brings into when, you know, birds and bats sit there and poop, okay? So this understanding has been used across the world to kind of, you know, develop these different kinds of perches which birds can sit on. Also different chemical odors that attract bats. Just leaving a few of these around can bring in a huge seed rain. All those treated, beautifully treated seeds. All you need to go is go and weed and remove the invasives. Okay, that's all your job becomes. Okay, and this accelerates seed rain and fertilization. It's very cost effective, very rapid. And it's also bringing in a natural mix of species that ecosystem services themselves are maintaining. You're not determining that species mix, okay? So it's much more flexible in that way, okay? There's lots of complexities involved, and the ecosystems are cycling these things in very, very complex ways, okay? There's also thought that we can put into about arrangement of these perches. And we do understand, I think, from a lot of work done, that animal behavior, rather than the source of the food, determines where the seeds land or where seeds germinate, okay? So perch density, perch arrangement can yield very different and contrasting results, okay? This understanding can also be used to kind of avoid, weeds coming up in a location if you understood how animals concentrate seeds in particular locations, okay? Well, to those of us who seek solutions, you know, smart cities that sustain ecological function and provide services to both humans and other species are designable, okay? We could dream of those and think of those, okay? And we can think of very small scale to large scale engineering, ecological engineering solutions, okay? They can be designed to be resilient and adaptable, but are we ready to do that? Okay, and to do that, I think we need closer coming together of different fields like what Piyush and Swati are trying to do here, and more of such interactions. Thank you, everyone, and I stop here.
There's a trend of this Miyawaki principle, and it's very much in right now. And everybody's just talking about it, quick forests. And so how do you perceive this whole thing happening of making quick forests and creating quick ecosystems? What is your take on this?
See, I was just wondering if the lantana seeds sit dormant in the seed bank, and given the kind of restoration approaches that you were talking about, sort of weed them out and keep them away for a fair amount of distance, do they, if at all they do sit dormant in the seed bank, do they sort of come up from those? And the other thing that you mentioned about allowing, once you sort of weed out the invasive species, allowing other species to come up, and then lantana sort of, growth of lantana suppressed or whatever to that effect, are there experiments that show basically this?
Do you want to take this before moving on?
Yeah. Miyawaki, I've been reading a bit about that. I'm not fully convinced. Okay, I don't think there are any quick solutions. I think there are knowledgeable solutions, and in almost every corner of India, we have people who have good natural history knowledge, or, you know, there are ecologists almost everywhere who can be consulted to design good solutions. Okay. But I'm not convinced that there's one solution that can apply to every corner of the country. They're just taking a bunch of very common species, and it's not convincing to me, at least. Okay, with the lantana thing, yes, there are well-documented experiments that have happened when, in the case, the one that I'm familiar with, which we published about as well, Chilla, where we had people being moved out. After that, two valleys, okay, both came under lantana management. In one, we had, and in both, there were very similar management protocols followed, okay. In one, we've had a recovery of, natural grassland ecosystems. In another, we continue to have lantana, okay. And the story is contrasting, they're just across from each other. And one where it's not grazed by domestic livestock anymore, and there's no fresh input of lantana seeds from outside, we don't have lantana anymore. In another way, we have continuous inputs of lantana, we have lantana, okay. We can only learn from that, okay.
Species,
yeah.
Should be removed, so that they are not disrupted. But what happens that when those invasive species, they become the livelihood for the local people? For example, I'm talking about the Uttarakhand, where the chur pines have taken over the deodhar. But then the chur pines, they have the, every part of that the species, they have become the livelihood for the local people. So then how do you do that?
See, I don't think chur pine is invasive. It's a misconception. Okay, there's a lot of competition between pine and oak, if you look at even fossil pollen records. And it varies depending on, you know, the amount of rainfall and fire frequency and stuff. Okay, there's this misconception that chur pine is invasive. Okay, so, and yeah, I mean, pines are around, they are not invasive. Okay, but there's a competition between those two kind of systems we have in the middle altitudes. Okay, yeah. Okay.
Soumya, you mentioned about some species, you know, there's misconceptions about species such as tamarind, you know, not being Indian, but they were actually like not in native species and so on. So there is another species, like the other species, especially, you know, what comes to mind is neem, which is being planted extensively in India in reserved forest areas, you know, so under the, I believe it's not a native species. But most people seem to think it is a native species. So, I mean, do you have any, like, your take on that?
So, I'll just ask a question, okay? It may seem indirect. How many of you are here from, are you native to Pune? Okay. Okay, how long are your family, how many of you have had families here who've been here longer than 100 years? Okay. Okay, fine. There's just two or three hands that are going up. But the rest of you still consider yourselves native to Pune, right? Now, these plants, neem, lantana, tamarind, have been here much longer, okay, than any of you who consider yourselves native to Pune, okay. I really don't know what's native, what's exotic, and that's, I think, a very, very hard definition, okay. It's very subjective, okay.
My observation is that neem is not, you know, naturally found in forests, so, like, it's, unless it's been deliberately planted, you know, but even today, if you look around, mostly neem is found like around, I mean, I'm just giving neem as an example, there will be probably other species also, which are found mostly around human like inhabitations, villages and so on. So, but it's only when you actually go and plant it in the forest areas that...
That's true of peninsular India, but in large parts of northwestern India, there are sites where neem has turned invasive. Okay. Yeah, we have situations where it is actually kind of just taking over and dominating systems right now.